Virtues and Vices by Aristotle, translated by J. Solomon. 1. The noble is the object of praise, the base of blame. At the head of what is noble stand the virtues, at the head of what is base the vices. The virtues, then, are objects of praise, but so also are the causes of the virtues, and their accompaniments and results, including the acts they give rise to. The opposites are objects of blame. If, in agreement with Plato, we take the soul to have three parts, then prudence is the virtue of the rational, gentleness and bravery of the passionate, temperance and continence of the appetitive, and of the soul as a whole, justice, liberality, and magnanimity. Folly is the vice of the rational, irascibility and cowardice of the passionate, intemperance and incontinence of the appetitive, and of the soul as a whole, injustice, illiberality, and small-mindedness. 2. Prudence is a virtue of the rational part, capable of procuring all that tends to happiness. Gentleness is a virtue of the passionate part, through which men become difficult to stir to anger. Bravery is a virtue of the passionate part, through which men are difficult to scare by apprehension of death. Temperance is a virtue of the appetitive part, by which men cease to desire bad sensual pleasures. Continence is a virtue of the appetitive part, by which men check, by thinking, the appetite that rushes to bad pleasures. Justice is a virtue of the soul, that distributes to each according to his desert. Liberality is a virtue of the soul, ready to spend on noble objects. Magnanimity is a virtue of the soul, by which men are able to bear good and bad fortune, honor and dishonor. 3. Folly is a vice of the rational part, causing evil living. Irascibility is a vice of the passionate part, through which men are easily stirred to anger. Cowardice is a vice of the passionate part, through which men are scared by apprehensions, especially such as relate to death. Intemperance is a vice of the appetitive part, by which men become desirous of bad sensual pleasures. Incontinence is a vice of the appetitive part, through which one chooses bad pleasures, though thinking opposes this. Injustice is a vice of the soul, through which men become covetous of more than they deserve. Illiberality is a vice of the soul, through which men aim at gain from every source. Little-mindedness is a vice of the soul, which makes men unable to bear alike good and bad fortune, alike honor and dishonor. 4. To prudence belongs right decision, right judgment as to what is good and bad, and all in life that is to be chosen and avoided, noble use of all the goods that belong to us, correctness in social intercourse, the grasping of the right moment, the sagacious use of word and deed, the possession of experience of all that is useful. Memory, experience, tact, good judgment, sagacity. Each of these either arises from prudence or accompanies it. Or possibly some of them are, as it were, subsidiary causes of prudence, such as experience and memory, while others are, as it were, parts of it, exempli gratia, good judgment and sagacity. To gentleness belongs the power to bear with moderation accusations and slights, not to rush hastily to vengeance, not to be easily stirred to anger, to be without bitterness or contentiousness in one's character, to have in one's soul quietude and steadfastness. To bravery belongs slowness to be scared by apprehensions of death, to be of good courage in dangers and bold in facing risks, and to choose a noble death rather than preservation in some base way, and to be the cause of victory. Also, it belongs to bravery to labor, to endure, and to choose to play the man, and there accompanies it readiness to dare, high spirits and confidence, and further, fondness for toil and endurance. To temperance belongs absence of admiration for the enjoyment of bodily pleasures, absence of desire for all base sensual enjoyment, fear of just ill repute, an ordered course of life, alike in small things and in great. And temperance is accompanied by discipline, orderliness, shame, caution. 5. To continence belongs the power to restrain by reason the appetite when rushing to base enjoyment of pleasures, endurance, steadfastness under natural want and pain. To justice belongs the capacity to distribute to each his deserts, to preserve ancestral customs and laws, and also the written law, to be truthful in matters of importance, to observe one's agreements. First, among acts of justice, come those towards the gods, then those to deified spirits, then those towards one's country and parents, then those towards the departed. Amongst these comes piety, which is either a part of justice or an accompaniment of it. Also, justice is accompanied by purity, truth, trust, and hatred of wickedness. To liberality, it belongs to be profuse of money on praiseworthy objects, to be extravagant in spending on a proper purpose, to be helpful and kind in disputed matters, and not to take from improper sources. The liberal man is also clean in his dress and house, ready to provide himself with what is not strictly necessary, but beautiful and enjoyable without profit, inclined to keep all animals that have anything peculiar or marvelous about them. Liberality is accompanied by a suppleness and ductility of disposition, by kindness, by pitifulness, by love for friends, for foreign intimates, for what is noble. It belongs to magnanimity to bear nobly and bravely alike good and bad fortune, honor and dishonor, not to admire luxury or attention or power or victory in contests, but to have a sort of depth and greatness of soul. The magnanimous is one who neither values living highly nor is fond of life, but is in disposition simple and noble, one who can be injured and is not prompt to avenge himself. The accompaniments of magnanimity are simpleness, nobleness, and truth. 6. To folly it belongs to judge things badly, to decide badly, to be bad in social intercourse, to use badly present goods, to think erroneously about what is good and noble as regards life. Folly is accompanied by ignorance, inexperience, incontinence, tactlessness, shortness of memory. Of irascibility there are three species: promptness to anger, peevishness, sullenness. It is the mark of the angry man to be unable to bear small slights or defeats, to be ready to punish, prompt at revenge, easily moved to anger by any chance word or deed. The accompaniments of irascibility are a disposition easily excited, ready changes of feeling, attention to small matters, vexation at small things, and all these rapid and on slight occasion. To cowardice it belongs to be easily moved by unimportant apprehensions, especially if relating to death or maiming of the body, and to suppose preservation in any manner to be better than a noble death. Its accompaniments are softness, unmanliness, despair, love of life. Beneath it, however, is a sort of caution of disposition and slowness to quarrel. To intemperance it belongs to choose the enjoyments of hurtful and base pleasures, to suppose that those living in such pleasures are in the highest sense happy, to love laughter, jeering, wit and levity, in word and deed. Its accompaniments are disarrangement, shamelessness, disorder, luxury, ease, negligence, contempt, dissipation. To incontinence it belongs to choose the enjoyment of pleasures though reason forbids, to partake of them nonetheless though believing it to be better not to partake of them, and while thinking one ought to do what is noble and profitable, still to abstain from these for the sake of pleasures. The accompaniments of incontinence are effeminacy, negligence, and generally the same as those of intemperance. 7. Of injustice there are three species: impiety, greed, outrage. Impiety is wrongdoing towards gods, deified spirits, the departed, one's parents, and one's country. Greed is wrongdoing in regard to agreements, claiming a share of the object in dispute beyond one's deserts. Outrage occurs when, in providing pleasure for oneself, one brings shame on others, whence Evenus says of it, "That which, while gaining nothing, still wrongs another." It belongs to injustice to violate ancestral customs and laws, to disobey enactments and rulers, to lie, to commit perjury, to violate agreements and pledges. The accompaniments of injustice are quibbling, charlatanry, unamiability, pretense, malignity, unscrupulousness. Of illiberality there are three species: pursuit of disgraceful gain, parsimony, stinginess. Pursuit of disgraceful gain, insofar as such men seek gain from all sources and think more of the profit than of the shame. Parsimony, insofar as they are unready to spend money on a suitable purpose. Stinginess, insofar as, while spending, they spend in small sums and badly, and are more hurt than profited from not spending in season. It belongs to illiberality to value money above everything, and to think no reproach can ever attach to what yields a profit. The life of the illiberal is servile, suited to a slave, and sordid, remote from ambition and liberality. The accompaniments of illiberality are attention to small matters, sullenness, small-mindedness, self-humiliation, lack of measure, ignobility, misanthropy. It belongs to small-mindedness to be able to bear neither honor nor dishonor, neither good nor ill fortune, but to grow braggart when honored, to be elated at small prosperities, to be unable to bear even the smallest deprivation of honor, to regard any ill success whatever as a great misfortune, to bewail oneself, and to be impatient over everything. Further, the small-minded man is such as to call every slight an outrage and a dishonor, even such as are inflicted through ignorance or forgetfulness. The accompaniments of small-mindedness are attention to small things, grumbling, hopelessness, self-humiliation. 8. In general, it belongs to virtue to make the condition of the soul good, using quiet and ordered motions, and in agreement with itself throughout all its parts. Whence the condition of a good soul seems a pattern of a good political constitution. It belongs also to virtue to do good to the worthy, to love the good and to hate the bad, not to be prompt either to chastise or seek vengeance, but to be placable, kindly, and forgiving. Its accompaniments are worth, equity, indulgence, good hope, good memory, and further all such qualities as love of home, love of friends, love of comrades, love of one's foreign intimates, love of men, love of the noble. All these qualities are among the laudable. The marks of vice are the opposites, and its accompaniments the opposites, and all these marks and accompaniments of vice belong to the class of the blamable. End of chapter 8, and end of On Virtues and Vices. Letter to Alexander, and Chapter 1 of Rhetoric to Alexander, by Aristotle. Translated by Edward Seymour Forster. Letter to Alexander. Aristotle to Alexander. Salutation. You write that you have often sent persons to me to urge upon me the project of noting down for you the principles of public speaking. It is not through indifference that I have put off doing so all this time, but because I was seeking how to write on this subject with more exactitude than anyone else who has concerned himself therewith. It was only natural that I should have such an intention, for just as you are desirous to have more splendid raiment than other men, so you ought to strive to attain to a more glorious skill in speech than other men possess. For it is far more honorable and kingly to have the mind well ordered than to see the bodily form well arrayed. For verily, it is absurd that one who in deeds excels all men should in words manifestly fall short of ordinary mortals, especially when he knows full well that, whereas among those whose political constitution is democracy, the final appeal on all matters is to the law, among those who are under kingly rule, the appeal is to reason. Just as their public law always directs self-governing communities along the best path, so might reason, as embodied in you, guide along the path of their advantage those who are subject to your rule. For law can be simply described as reason defined by the common consent of the community, regulating action of every kind. Furthermore, I think that you are well aware that we praise as good men and true those who employ reason and prefer always to act under its guidance, while we abhor as savage and brutish those who act in any matter without reason. It is for this cause, too, that we punish wicked men when they show their wickedness and admire the good when they display their virtue. Thus we have discovered a means of preventing possible wickedness, while we enjoy the benefits of existing goodness. In this way we escape annoyances which threaten us, and secure advantages which we did not previously possess. Just as a life free from pain is an object of desire, so is wise reason an object of contentment. Again, you must realize that the model set before most men is either the law or else your life and the expression of your reason. In order, therefore, that you may excel all Greeks and barbarians, you must exert yourself to the utmost, so that those who spend their lives in these pursuits, using the elements of virtue in them to produce a beauteous copy of the model thus set before them, may not direct themselves towards ignoble ends, but make it their desire to partake in the same virtue. Moreover, deliberation is the most divine of human activities. Therefore, you must not waste your energies on subordinate and worthless pursuits, but desire to drink at the very fountainhead of good counsel. For what man of sense could ever doubt that, while it is a sign of foolishness to act without deliberation, it is the mark of true culture to accomplish under the guidance of reason anything that reason commands? It is plain to see that all the greatest politicians of Greece resort to reason first, and then to deeds, and further, that those who have won the highest repute among the barbarians have employed reason before action, knowing full well that the consideration of expediency by the light of reason is a very citadel of salvation. Yea, it is reason which we must regard as an impregnable citadel, and not look on any fortress built by man as a sure safeguard. But I hesitate to say another word, lest I should seem to be writing for effect, bringing forward proofs of facts which are fully known as though they were not generally admitted. I will, therefore, say no more after mentioning only one topic, in enlarging on which one might spend one's whole life, namely, that reason is the one thing wherein we are superior to all other animals, we who have received the highest honor which heaven can bestow. For all animals display the appetites and desire and the like, but none save man possess reason. Now, it would be most strange if, when it is by virtue of reason alone that we live happier lives than all other animals, we should through indifference despise and renounce that which is the cause of our well-being. Though you have long been exhorted thereto, I urge you to embrace with the utmost zeal the study of reasoned speech. For just as health preserves the body, so is education the recognized preserver of the mind. Under its guidance, you will never take a false step in anything that you do, but you will keep safe practically all the advantages which you already possess. Moreover, if physical sight is a pleasure, to see clearly with the eyes of the soul is a thing to be admired. Again, as the general is the savior of his army, so is reason, allied with education, the guide of life. These, then, and like sentiments, I think I may well dismiss at the present moment. In your letter, you urge me not to let this book fall into other hands than yours, and this, knowing full well that, just as parents love their own offspring more than supposititious children, so those who have invented something have more affection for it than those to whom the discovery is merely imparted. For men have died in defense of their words, as they would die for their offspring. For the so-called Parian sophists, because what they teach is not of their own production, in their gross indifference feel no affection and barter it away for money. Wherefore I exhort you to watch over these precepts, the children of my brain, that while they are yet young, they may be corrupted by no man, and sharing in your well-ordered life, when they come to man's estate, may win unsullied glory. Following the lesson taught by Nicanor, we have adopted from other authors anything on the same subjects which was particularly well expressed in their treatises. You will find two such books, one of which is my own, Videlicet, the oratorical art, which I wrote for Theodectes, while the other is the treatise of Corax. The other points connected with public and forensic exhortations have all been dealt with specially in these treatises. So in these commentaries, written expressly for you, you will find material for amplifying these two treatises. Farewell. 1. public speeches fall into three classes: deliberative, epideictic, and forensic. They are of seven kinds, being employed in persuasion, dissuasion, eulogy, vituperation, accusation, defense, and inquiry either by itself or in relation to something else. Such are the different kinds of discourses and their number. We shall employ them in public harangues, in lawsuits about contracts, and in private conversation. We shall treat of them most conveniently if we take them each separately and enumerate their qualities, their uses, and their arrangement. And first, let us discuss persuasion and dissuasion, since they are used most of all in private conversations and in public harangues. To speak generally, persuasion is an exhortation to some purpose or speech or action.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.